Letting everyone file in virtually. As you come in, feel free to say hello in the chat. Let us know who you are, what industry or sector you work in, and say hello. My name is Lee Constable. I'm your host today. I'll start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land in which I am broadcasting to you from. I'm here on the land of the Gadigal and Bidjigal people, so I wanted to pay my respects to elders past and present, and also acknowledge the ongoing relationship and thousands, tens of thousands of years worth of history of Indigenous innovation and science, engineering, and knowledge in general. Welcome, everyone, to this, which is the latest instalment in the Innovation Series. This is hosted by Science Meets Business and ANSTO. Please say hello in the chat. Let us know whose land you're on, the First Nations land you're on. Let us know what sector you're in, what drew you to this. It's great to see Karis is in the chat there. You'll be seeing more from Karis throughout this, sharing more links related to what we're talking about. Michael, hello, great to see you. And please also we'll go to our panelists. Please feel free to keep using that chat to ask questions and make comments and have chats amongst yourselves even throughout. We have a very engaged audience for this series and we really enjoy it. So today's topic is about strengthening the future of the nuclear workforce here in Australia. And that's not just nuclear engineering, physics, medicine, or any other area of science. That's also radioactivity and isotope science. That's also beyond science. We're going to be talking about other types of careers, policy, law, everything across the supply chain, from safety to maintenance to regulation, as well as diplomacy, given that this is a global topic of interest. Obviously, this is something that we have seen more and more talk of in Parliament. For instance, in the recent budget, there was money in there for student placements to learn skills related to the planned nuclear subs, as well as money going towards the Australian radioactive waste industry. Now, sovereign capability has become a big topic related not just to the nuclear industry, but everywhere. And it's not just a buzzword. It is an important thing for us to consider, as well as what it means when we have an aging workforce or a gap between the need and the skills and knowledge. These are all topics we'll be talking about today because we have seen in so many countries the nuclear workforce can be massive. For example, a 2019 study in Canada found that the nuclear workforce accounted for 76,000 jobs, which was up from 60,000 in 2012. Now, throughout, as I said, please ask questions. I will start by introducing each of our panelists one by one and giving them each an opportunity to sink their teeth into a big question to start off with. And then after that, we'll invite everyone in for more of a conversational tone. And I'm sure you'll by then we'll have more questions than we can handle, which will be great. The first guest who I will invite to join me here on screen is Venessa Barrins, who's the General Manager of People Performance and Capability at ANSTO. With almost 30 years of HR experience, Venessa has worked at global investment banking and some of Australia's top financial institutes. Since joining ANSTO in 2012, she's implemented a wide range of HR initiatives to meet organisational strategies. And I'll let you read the rest of her bio. But Venessa, just wanted to get you to give people an idea of what sort of skills are needed and what sort of people do we need to attract or train when it comes to the future of the nuclear workforce?
Thanks, Lee. It's a great question, a very broad question. And I think you provided a really good context on how vast and wide the nuclear sector is. And to put into perspective, even though the nuclear sector in Australia is still relatively small compared to other countries, the depth of disciplines and the depth of skills and experience goes across a variety of science disciplines, engineering disciplines, STEM and non-STEM disciplines to support the workforce. And to put it into perspective, you know, ANSTO's been operating for about 70 years. We do very exciting, innovative work in science, as well as other areas and programs. There's lots of exciting engineering programs that cover a variety of engineering disciplines as they are in science disciplines. We have a lot of supporting functions that support these disciplines as well, like your corporate functions and so forth. And to put it into perspective, ANSTO is Australia's leading supplier of nuclear science medicines to the community. We've been around, like I said, for about 70 years now. We produce radioisotopes that enables around 12,000 nuclear medicine procedures each week, and they go out to on a weekly basis to hospitals all around Australia. So it is quite a vast spread of how we touch the community and the benefit there is to the community. And I think when we're looking at attracting attracting candidates into the nuclear workforce, it's important to connect with the community. People who want to join organizations generally want to see how the organizations align with their values and things like that. So it's important when we look at our strategies of attracting candidates that we align to the community, and we also educate the community on the benefits and the positives around a nuclear career, nuclear workforce.
Yeah, thank you so much. That's a really good way for us to start this discussion with these things in mind. And we'll have plenty more time to ask Venessa questions. So do start thinking of those in the audience here. I also wanted to say hello to everyone in the chat. Thank you so much. All of you have been great at letting us know where you're from, what brings you here. And it's great to see so many different sectors and parts of the country represented in there. So hello, everyone. The next guest who I will introduce is Associate Professor Tony Hooker, who's Director of the Centre for Radiation Research, Education and Innovation at University of Adelaide. Now, Tony is a radiation biologist with research interests in mechanisms of radiation-induced damage. Tony returned to academia in 2019 as inaugural director of the centre and after 12 years as a principal radiation health advisor for SA government, and has a very interesting and diverse nuclear career yourself, Tony. It's great to have you here. Now, I wanted to ask you if you could start by letting us know what is the sector like in Australia? Where are there gaps when it comes to things like our sovereign capability or passing knowledge on and this topic of training and education?
Yeah, thanks, Lee. Firstly, thanks to Science Meets Business and ANSTO for inviting me along here. Australia has a shortage of radiation professionals across the board. Everyone's starting to get to my age, which is old, and so we need to start thinking about the next generation. Look, it's not just gaps in nuclear, there's gaps, so we talk about nuclear education, but we're also talking about radiation education, radiation protection, radiation safety, radiation emergency preparedness and response. And so there's gaps all through those areas, and that's one of the things that we were looking to do when we established this centre, is to give to develop some training education packages to develop the next generation of radiation professionals. And now, knowing what's coming up with AUKUS and other activities, Australian Radioactive Waste Agency, and a whole range of other industries needing a workforce, it has actually, we sort of picked the right time to do it. There's outside of the medical physics, nuclear medicine, diagnostic radiography type tertiary level qualifications, there's some courses which push into nuclear physics, but some of those are not really directed in a particular area. So you end up with a real broad range of knowledge, and what we're trying to do is to provide some specialist activities.
Yeah, thank you, Tony. And we will get more into what that looks like at the tertiary level, but also, you know, even from school. And I will ask you more about that soon. But now I need to introduce my third guest, who is Professor Hugh Durrant-Whyte, who is New South Wales Chief Scientist and Engineer. Hugh is a world-leading authority on machine learning and robotics and applications in areas including cargo handling, mining and defence. He has published over 300 research papers, graduated over 70 PhD students and won numerous awards and prizes for his work, including being named 2010 New South Wales Scientist of the Year and 2008 Engineers Australia New South Wales Engineer of the Year. Welcome, Professor Durrant-Whyte. And I think something that people may not know about Hugh is that you actually had a beginning in nuclear specifically. Now, you said that nuclear specializations as part of a broader degree program in mechanical engineering is not necessarily the best pathway. Could you please talk to us about your pathway and where you see the future of nuclear pathways?
Yeah, my undergraduate degree was actually in nuclear engineering, and I worked for Rolls-Royce, and in fact was part of the team that designed the PWR-2, which is the reactor that drives the Astute submarine. And I also worked on, a long time ago, small SMRs, basically, 40 years ago, even though they still haven't really been put into production. So I have some background in the area. My view is the following. I mean, if you look at where different countries are at this point, you don't need thousands of nuclear engineers, I think is the first thing. You know, if you look to the UK, which not only has a military but a civilian nuclear industry, there's only actually one undergraduate nuclear degree program, which takes only about 15 people a year. And it's not dissimilar in truth in Canada or the US. What you do see, though, is a lot of other disciplines like mechanical engineering or electrical engineering or physics or whatever that move into the industry, because a lot of running a power nuclear reactor or any of these sorts of things is to do with materials, fluid flow, lots of things that you would learn in a normal degree, and then potentially specialize through something like a master's program, a 1 year or 2 year master's program in understanding things like neutron damage in materials or neutron flux and moderators and things and so on, which kind of makes the degree you've been doing relevant in the nuclear industry. So I suspect that's more of the way things are likely to evolve, if you like, the degree level kind of thing. I'll come back to other roles in a minute. So my view is I suspect we don't really need an undergraduate degree in the nuclear sector. What I think we perhaps need are graduate courses that are able to take people who have that background and are able to migrate them into that field. And there could be specializations within that, radiation health versus power nuclear reactors, et cetera. When you look at the number you quoted, 70,000 people in Canada, I did a little bit of background on that last night, you know, of those, probably only 10,000 are specialist nuclear people, right? The rest of them are really support in terms of logistics, technical staff, a whole range of other ancillary things that keep the whole supply chain together. I mean, it's the same as with, running a medical system, like a health industry. Not everybody has to be a surgeon. There are lots of other people that go to make that work. So I think one thing we could profitably do as a group is to really actually understand what their layout of that workforce might need to be in Australia, and therefore perhaps what things we actually need to do and start building now. I'll stop there.
Great. Thank you so much. That's some also great points for us to consider. Also that broadness of what it means to work in the nuclear industry. I just wanted to say thank you to people sharing resources in the chat as well. Michael has shared that the Australian Institute of Nuclear Science and Engineering offers a number of educational schools and scholarships to facilitate uni sector connections with ANSTO. Also, Karis has shared that ANSTO offers two programs there as well. Now, Caitlin's in the chat saying, Women in Nuclear Australia dialing in from Durrawal Land, currently following along on Twitter. That's great to hear, because my next guest that I will introduce is here representing Women in Nuclear. So I wanted to introduce Jasmin Diab, who is President of Women in Nuclear Australia. Jasmin's a mum, leader, nerd and diversity advocate, her words. She's also joined the Australian Army in 2001 after graduating from Australian Defence Force Academy and Royal Military College. Duntroon was allocated to Royal Australian Engineers as a combat engineer. She's got a background in explosive ordnance disposal. She spent the majority of her career providing operational and training support in countering chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, and explosive threats. And she's seen operational service both domestically and overseas. She's a big advocate for women's careers in nuclear. And so I wanted to ask you if you could introduce those who don't know to what Women in Nuclear Australia is and what you're all about.
Thanks, Lee, and thanks everyone for dialing in. So Women in Nuclear Australia is part of a larger Women in Nuclear global organisation, which is a not-for-profit established primarily to showcase women who work professionally in nuclear and radiological applications. So not just science and engineering, we also have a heap of lawyers and policymakers. Anyone that touches the nuclear sector, we include them. We're also, whilst women's in the title, our membership is open to all genders. But what it's really about is showcasing voices in nuclear discussions that aren't commonly heard, and especially in Australia, where we have such a small nuclear industry, our part is to try and prop up and say, hey, whilst we're a small industry, there's a lot we do in nuclear that's really, really important. There's some amazing research that a lot of people do around nuclear. And I guess the real joy I have with Women in Nuclear is that we have an international network, and I get to travel the world and meet my colleagues all across the place. And I visited Fukushima last year, and before the COVID lockdown, had visited a nuclear waste facility in Spain, all through Women in Nuclear. So I think there's lots of opportunities in a nuclear career, no matter what your background is. It's just an exciting place to work in. So I'm really looking forward to talking more about how I think Australia's future nuclear workforce could be influenced to help support that.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jasmin. And so now that I've introduced all of our guests, I wanted to remind you all in chat, in the audience, to get your questions out there. Let me know if a question for the whole panel or anyone who might be able to answer, or maybe you've got a question for someone specifically. Karis is also going to be sharing links in the chat too, so watch out for those. Now, we have talked a little bit about the training and the education needed and the types of careers that are needed when it comes to a nuclear future, whether that's through technical skills or through all of those other roles that actually make up even more of the nuclear industry. One thing I wanted to ask our panel to talk about next is about the other side of things, which isn't just about training people to work in nuclear, but also communicating with the public and educating the public around nuclear so we can see the benefits as well as be aware of the risks, because I think sometimes we have a public discussion that focuses only on the negatives and not on all of the positives and benefits that you all see. Now, we had a chat when I met the panel about talking to kids about nuclear. Now, Venessa, and I think it was also you, Tony, who might want to talk about that. Tony, I just want to throw to you first. Why is it important, and how can we actually talk to school-age children about nuclear?
I think it's extremely important. And so one of the biggest issues that we have is that the general community is they're often fearful of radiation because they don't have all of the information. And certainly with the Nuclear Fuel Cycle Royal Commission that we had in South Australia, I was involved in the Community Consultation and Response Agency doing a lot of public education, schools, town halls and shopping centres. And clearly a lot of people don't have all of that information. So it's really important to engage as many people as possible. We're quite lucky here in South Australia. We have a science fair once a year, Science Alive. We'll have 30,000 people come through and we teach them all about radiation from mobile phones, base stations, all the way up to x-rays and medical radiation. So it's extremely important and we need to do more of it. We need to get out into the schools and we need to be able to, I guess, provide our teachers with that correct information as well.
Yeah, great. And Venessa, I know that ANSTO is interested in this sort of outreach. Can you give us some more information on that?
Yeah, sure. So we do a lot of outreach with our local schools. We've got a discovery centre at ANSTO that does a lot of outreach within the local schools around the community. We have tens of thousands of students that come and do a tour at ANSTO every year. There's busloads of schools that come out. And like Tony said, you know, we need to be more proactive. Industry needs to be more proactive and the nuclear industry needs to be more proactive and get out into the schools and influence students at a much younger age. I would say even in primary schools is where we need to start targeting and influencing and demonstrating to students what careers in a nuclear workforce looks like. I think we've already alluded to the vast disciplines there are out there. And as Professor Hugh said, you know, they all don't have to be a nuclear background, but they are, like when I talk to my colleagues at ANSTO, you know, we need the general disciplines. We need the mechanical engineers, the mechatronic engineers. They don't all have to do a master's in nuclear engineering to support a nuclear workforce. But we do need to do more in schools as a community and collaborate a lot more so that the kids are selecting the right subjects much earlier in the piece before they even get into high schools and universities.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I know there's a link there to the teacher resources. I myself went on a grade 12 science excursion to the Big Smoke to see ANSTO and other places. Also, Igor in the chat said that in WA, we are increasing the amount of nuclear physics in year 11 high schools starting in 2025, which is interesting to learn. And Fiona says the Discovery Centre and programs at ANSTO are excellent, and so is the website with plenty of excellent resources. I think an area that could have more material are YouTube clips. That's a really good point because we know that young people interact with and engage with different types of media through social. I now wanted to bring Hugh back on screen. Hugh, as in your role when it comes to New South Wales Chief Scientist and Engineer, what do you see as the main places where the state of New South Wales is a part of this whole nuclear workforce of the future?
We do a lot of areas, obviously. Sorry, I should just start my video. Sorry. There we go. ANSTO, of course, is in New South Wales, so we collaborate quite a bit with you already. We have a number of STEM programs. None of them are actually, interestingly, in nuclear per se. And maybe there's an opportunity. We don't do our own STEM programs, but we fund existing STEM programs. But to the best of my knowledge, none of those is in specifically in nuclear or related disciplines. So there may be an opportunity to do something in that area. I'd say the other thing we do a lot and is worthwhile mentioning is we do try and train the general population more often. So we run breakfast seminars in Parliament House, which are very well attended. Thousands of people come to them. Just as important is actually, if you don't mind me saying, educating the politicians, who also, frankly, don't usually know much more than a year 12 student and probably need to. So as you're aware, last year, there was indeed yet another parliamentary inquiry into the nuclear industry in New South Wales. You know, I think those are the sorts of things where we should be aiming to train our representatives to understand a little bit more the ins and outs of what it means to have or to not have a nuclear industry. And if we are going to, what that means in terms of training and processes and supply chains and everything else that goes along.
Yeah, thanks so much, Hugh. Haniel in the Q&A function has said, as an external service provider to ANSTO, how can we partner with the organisation to support the advocacy of the industry to school-age kids? Also, Karis has shared one YouTube video for you, Fiona, there, although she does note for watching later. So would you like to speak to that question, Venessa?
Sure, and I guess it is something that organisations and industry does need to partner a lot more with providers, customers, clients that we work with. When I've done a little bit of research into overseas nuclear industries, which have been well established, Europe, the States, there is a very strong collaborations between government, industry and education sector. And that goes to partnering a lot more. There's no point duplicating work. It's leveraging off expertise that are already existing and out there. So I do encourage a lot more collaboration.
Great to hear. Thank you. The next thing I wanted to ask about now, Jasmin, I know that you have really enjoyed your career and you say that it's given you opportunities that you wouldn't have otherwise had. What are some of those, apart from the opportunities, some of those barriers or things that you're still hoping to see addressed to attract women and doubtless other people to the industry that might otherwise be discouraged or leave early?
Yes, yeah, so thanks, Lee. This is, I guess, targeted at STEM careers in nuclear. There is something a little bit different to a nuclear career in either research or development, where you need to be exposed to radiation in some circumstances in a safe manner. Now, for a lot of women, we go through parts of our career where we want to have children, we want to settle down, and that puts a little blip in your career if you can't safely be working around radiation, let's say if you're in a research and development role. So finding careers that are broad enough to allow women to have a good long living career in the nuclear field will allow that talent to stay. We've had previous members that have left the nuclear community because it just didn't fit in with family life. And so we're losing all these people to other careers because it's quite easy to retrain in another field once you've got a background in nuclear science and engineering. And we just don't get them back because there's also limited pathways later in career. So finding more creative ways for people to enter in and maintain a nuclear career, I think, is one of the challenges that we really have. We don't have a private nuclear power industry that allows people to have jobs in different areas. Like, I know countries like Sweden and Finland and Canada that have nuclear power, they have women working in their power plants and they just change roles temporarily whilst they need to. We just don't.
And you mean, sorry, when they're pregnant or trying?
When they're pregnant, it's only if they're in those radiation safety positions. Most positions in power plants or research reactors are radiation safe, but we don't want to close off the door for women to be reactor engineers or to be working on a neutron beam line in the case in some research areas. So how do we allow them to have those careers and potentially just bounce out into a different role temporarily and then come back in when they're ready to? I think that's one of the small challenges in nuclear, that we need to be a bit more creative in how we do it so we don't lose all that talent and we have people of all genders having great careers in the nuclear industry long term.
Yeah, thank you for that. And Tony, I know you want to add to this because you're also concerned about that whole talent retention thing.
What Jasmin has said is you know, true and correct for women in nuclear, but it's also true and correct for women in STEM in general. And it is tough out there. It's tough for everybody because you're on a, you know, you're applying for grants if you're in the research space, and either you get this publish or perish mentality. So if you're, you know, if a woman takes a significant amount of time off for maternity leave, yes, you can write it in your grant that there was an interruption to your productivity, But it is actually really difficult out there. It's and you can sort of understand why people don't undertake a career in STEM, because it's unless you've got a nice permanent full-time job, which most of us in university, we do not. We work on contracts. So publish or perish, bring in money.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And one other thing while I've got you, Tony, is I know you've touched on when we chatted on Monday that there's this thing where you might have a PhD graduate, but then there might not be that job. But down the track, how do you, you know, not lose them forever into another career and attract them back, or keep them up to date with their knowledge and skills?
Yeah, that is, again, it's really tough out there. So one of the things that, you know, we certainly think about all the time is that we might train somebody up, but where is their job at the end of it? And, there's been a lot of talk about AUKUS and you know, sovereign capability, but those submarines are, you know, way down the line. So if I train someone up tomorrow, what are they going to do, and, you know, for them to come online? So, look, it is a challenge. But the biggest problem is that, like I said before, I think if you look at the ARC Register of Nuclear Physicist Professors, I think they have a list of 8 in the country.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not one of them. They're going to be retired soon. So, you know, we do need to start thinking about this and then think about where they might actually work until we need them.
Yeah. And radioactivity science, you know, isotope science, nuclear, these are global fields, and it is a global workforce, so we can lose people overseas as well.
And that's one of the things. So our centre is a capacity building centre for the International Atomic Energy Agency. So we're looking at developing tertiary education programs. You know, may, like you said before, maybe not at that PhD level, but maybe at the grad cert, certificate, you know, master's level, to give people extra qualifications. So that's some of the work that we're doing.
Thanks very much, Tony. In the chat, there's been lots of great activity. Bridget has put the email address there for ANSTO Discovery Centre and says to please get in touch if you want tours or education programs for school students, PD for school teachers, free online education resources, potential future collaborations. They're happy to hear from you or point you in another useful direction if they can't help directly. Caitlin also says Women in Nuclear Australia is a great resource for women navigating some of the challenges around pregnancy and family while working in nuclear. Many of us have been there. We are always happy for people to reach out for advice, which is lovely to hear. I've got a question from Freya who says, I've recently relocated from the UK, where I supported and managed nuclear materials research programs for over 15 years. When I began, there was a cliff edge in the UK nuclear industry, with a huge number of impending retirements at all levels. UK has been rebuilding this, but there are key lessons to learn from that. What are the panel's thoughts on how we ensure we achieve this knowledge transfer? To use a positive example, how do we ensure that people making careers choices are aware of all the available opportunities in this field? Our group employability in the UK was top notch. I invite anyone from the panel to jump in on this and answer Freya's question. I know Jasmine's got her hand up. Do you want to come in first, Jasmine?
Sure. I think what we're really working on at the moment, between not just Women in Nuclear Australia, but also the Australian Nuclear Association and the Australian Young Generation Nuclear, is building that network so that people can find the right mentors and role models to build the career that suits them. I think networking is really key here. And it's unfortunate that the bulk of our membership is Sydney-centric, and that's natural because ANSTO is here. We do need to have better networking opportunities across Australia, because there are nuclear and radiation careers all across. We need to keep that networking open to all, to allow people to understand what careers are out there. How did people navigate? Did they have opportunities overseas for a short period of time to then come back to Australia? Are there opportunities in other states that we just aren't tracking? So I think my perspective on this is that we need to be better at networking, and we are trying as not-for-profit organisations to get that networking happening across all nuclear radiation sector in Australia.
Yeah, that's good to hear. Jeffrey also pointed out the issue of remuneration offerings competing with external businesses for a reducing workforce. Does the panel see the current structured remuneration system of levels and grades which exist in government sector as a hurdle to growing the sector? Does this system have a life? Will it need to be overhauled to attract people? I don't know, Hugh, do you want to jump in on that? I know, Tony, you'll probably also have a view on that.
Well, I was going to let Hugh go first, but...
you can jump in, Tony.
First of all, just to the, the cliff. Australia's been pretty poor at succession planning, and I know that throughout, you know, my own time in government, and I know that there's some government agencies which are heading towards a huge cliff at this point in time. So succession planning should always be, on a business, looking forward. Regarding pay salaries for government people, they are pretty poor compared to, private industry or even university. So that was my experience. I'll let Hugh answer that.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Tony. Hugh, what was your experience when it comes to remuneration, or do you have an idea of whether this will need an overhaul?
So I'll come back. Sorry, they wouldn't let me start my video. So hang on. Okay. I wanted to come back to one other thing first, which is this issue around the workforce as it is now. There's no question in my experience, a lot of the training is mentorship, because the nuclear industry, particularly, let's say, if we are ever going to get into power reactors in this country, and that means both submarines or civilian or anything else, we have next to no experience in that at all. And when I was in the field, I had a lot of people who were 20 years or more, 30 years more experience in understanding these things. And so much of it is not really a science, it's an art. It's, really understanding what things are important, how they work, how they come together. It's nothing that you ever get from a textbook or a course. I worry from the longevity point of view that we don't have anything in place that allows us to do that. If I go back again to my experience in the UK, I had a second time back in the UK when I was chief scientist for the Ministry of Defence. And I looked after the whole nuclear workforce for defence, amongst other things. And so much of it there was really creating this pipeline of people who knew how to design these and to operate these things, which were really immensely complicated systems, in general. So I think that's a real challenge. Look, government jobs can play well. I work in government at the moment, and I also work in the private sector, and I also work at a university. So I have all three. I think the challenge is the salaries at any one level. What there isn't often in government is a career progression for people who are technically skilled. Right. So if you're a radiation scientist in a division of government that's supposed to regulate the nuclear industry, just as an example, there's no obvious way at this point that you could progress easily to becoming secretary of the department or, a senior person in that department, if that makes sense. Because the technical fields are not as well established as they are, in the private sector. So very often the civil servants who become senior are generalists and not specialists, okay? So again, I'll come back to my previous experience, and I've seen this a lot in the US, is the actual construction of career paths for technical specialists that genuinely allow them to progress in that area. And in fact, again, when I said I looked after the nuclear people in defence, I had oversight over all the engineers in defence. And my role to a large degree was to actually create career paths for who people who were technical specialists in a business which was really about the armed services, you know, so that senior engineering people were also become senior people in defence, if you see what I mean.
Mm.
Sense. And so I think we need to do that here, but there is, again, no track record of doing that either at federal or at state level in Australia.
Yeah, thanks for that perspective, Hugh. I might just go to Darren's question. Darren was wondering more about the issue of concerned mums and dads, people in our community who don't understand and therefore are really worried about things like 5G. How do we as science communicators keep nuclear misinformation and disinformation at bay? I want to throw to Jasmin on this one.
Yeah. Thanks, Lee, and great question, Darren. So I think for a really long time, nuclear has been taboo in Australia. It's something we don't talk about. People automatically shut down and don't want to engage when you try to talk to them about that, which means we've got generations of Australians that don't understand nuclear, and what they do understand is what is sensationalised by pop fiction. So things like the Chernobyl miniseries and The Simpsons, that's how they get their understanding of nuclear. So it's really hard for people who, and I'm talking about myself here, I think logically nuclear makes sense to me. I understand how atoms work. It's hard for me to communicate that to someone who brings emotion in to that. So we need to get better at listening to why people are concerned about nuclear, speaking in clear language that allows them to be included in that conversation, not just going straight to, hey, a reactor core has fuel and the fuel generates neutrons. Vroom, you've lost a whole heap of people by going straight into that technical detail. Rather, be inclusive, use clear language that's understood, and people will make up their mind and understand that nuclear is not as terrifying as the media has made it out to be previously. So I think there's a lot of work we need to do as nuclear and radiation professionals to be more inclusive in our language when we explain nuclear and radiation to the general public, because a lot of them just don't know, and they haven't had the opportunity to know because it hasn't been readily spoken about in Australia. We just shut down that conversation. So I'm actually really excited that AUKUS has opened up nuclear to be a topic that we can discuss, and we can discuss it and allow people to understand more about it. But great question, Darren. I completely agree that this is something we need to do more of.
Yeah, thanks, Jasmin. And I'll also get Venessa, if you could speak from ANSTO's perspective. I know you spend a lot of your time talking to people, not just about how nuclear works, but the benefits that they're already having in their daily lives that we often don't see because it's literally invisible to us all. How do you kind of tackle disinformation and misinformation through ANSTO?
Yeah, absolutely. Look, like our panelist said, the nuclear perception in Australia is probably not a very positive one. And I think that's because people don't quite understand it. The nuclear sector is a relatively small sector and people come to their own conclusions. They jump to conclusions when they hear about something related to nuclear that might be unsafe, but it may not be in Australia. To be honest, ANSTO is probably the safest workplace I have ever worked in. The protocols around working in a nuclear environment is taken so seriously. And there's a lot more education that we need to do to the community around nuclear workplaces, nuclear environments. We're heavily regulated. The protocols around safety, security, everything that encompasses is so well, you know, embedded in the culture of the workplace. So it is about educating the community, the general community, a lot more around this, yeah, and to build that trust with the community.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I often notice when it comes to communicating about controversial topics, sometimes there are risks or concerns that aren't necessarily legitimate, and that's one thing, but other times it's like, well, that's a legitimate concern, but did you know how much we're doing to combat that? Louise in the chat also said, well, Louise is keen to get in touch with you, Bridget, but also super keen to have fabulous people in nuclear careers to engage in our schools. Louise's role is to get as many real world experiences into schools through syllabus links, cross curriculum projects, as well as micro credentials mapped to complex competencies. And Louise has left her email in the chat there for anyone who's interested in getting in touch. Tony, please come back on screen. And I know you've probably got a lot of things to say about the last few topics.
I actually think the radiation health issues, so when I was working for government, I used to get 90% of all radiation health inquiries from, like I was talking before, mobile phones, electromagnetic fields, and 90% of those inquiries were all about non-ionizing radiation, and because people are so concerned. So one of the things that we did is we lend out meters and let the people do their own science. As we give them some instructions on electromagnetic fields. They take this meter away, and then they own their own data, and then we can come back and analyze it for them. So that is a really good way of getting some education across.
Yeah.
But as what's been said earlier, get out into the schools. I take radiation sources. I take some nuclear medicine isotopes. I take some other radiation sources. I take all these detectors out, and we have fun. But there's some science in the background of that, and so that's to try and encourage those kids into science. I also go out to RSLs, University of Third Age, bowling clubs, anyone who asks, So my suggestion is to everybody who's on that chat who has some sort of level of radiation experience is try and get out into your community and educate. It's actually quite rewarding.
Yeah, great. And it sounds like if you are in South Australia particularly, maybe you should ask Tony, because he just said, I'll go anywhere.
of course. It's really important. Now, I should also point out, and I don't know where it's at anymore, there used to be the CSIRO, Scientists in Schools program, and I was part of that for a while, but I didn't have any requests from teachers, but if teachers certainly ask, we're very happy to go and help, and we can also provide some different types of experiments as well.
Great. Thank you so much, Tony. I also see that Anson has said DSTG, for those who don't know, that's Defence Science and Technology Group, is currently recruiting undergraduates to join their summer vacation program. It'd be a great opportunity for brilliant minds to gain STEM work experience in a large organisation. And there's a link there. Thank you so much. Karis also points out the importance of role models. Lots of them are available, and there's a link there to careers with STEM. And Igor says, University of the Third Age really appreciate science talks. They almost all have grandchildren. Yeah, that cross-generation communication is really important. And Kara says, we see the same with young people in STEM. Children as young as 7 or 8 are seeing stereotypes on TV or movies that put them off science. So having a career chat with children at a young age is a good way to help avoid that misinformation and disinformation. And Peter says, it will be interesting to see where the clean energy debate goes. Absolutely. Marguerite has asked a question, has said, not so much a question, but an offer of letting everyone know ATSI focuses on careers in and related to technological sciences and engineering. And we regularly engage our IMNIS it's gone. Sorry, let me go to another screen. I can still see it. Catalyst and Elevate Scholars are part of our STEM careers initiative in our Stellar STEM education activities, with a link there. We might have to copy paste that into the chat so everyone can see and see that link too. She says, we love to feature experts and rising stars in all we do. So another great invitation for collaboration. Paul shared a link here, 50% target women in STEM announcement, which is great to see. And Elizabeth says, lessons in chemistry launches on Apple TV. There you go. This is great. This has been a great exchange of information in the chat, as well as questions, which we love to see. Thank you, everyone. We've only got another 10 minutes, which honestly will fly by. So please do get your questions out there for any of our panelists if you have them. It's been great to listen to all our panelists talk about the many different ways that we can improve and adapt our potential future careers. I wanted to ask each of our panelists if you could let me know your predictions. Now, I'm sure none of them, maybe all of them will be right. I'm not sure. No pressure, but it is hard to know what's next, what's coming as far as nuclear, not just in Australia, but globally. It is a global thing. So what do you think might be coming, and what do you think we can do to make sure we're adaptable and ready for the future of these careers? I might go to you first, Venessa.
Just trying to get the video started.
All good?
Yeah.
Oh. There you are. Oh, we lost you. No, you're back.
There we go. Okay. that's a tough question, to be honest. Look, with the research that I've done a little bit to understand what's the nuclear sector look like both nationally and internationally, there is a lot of work happening within the nuclear sector. Let's face it, it's going to grow in Australia with the announcement of AUKUS and the new submarine enterprise workforce that's going to be required. Overseas as well, there's a lot of work happening with nuclear plants that are requiring decommissioning. So the skills and the knowledge is going to be in demand internationally and internationally. And we have to be very mindful and strategic about that. We are also government agencies. So, you know, there's always a challenge of losing people to the public sector and the private sector and so forth. So I think that the nuclear workforce is going to grow substantially. There is a high demand for it. And it's going to be lots of influencing within schools for students to be picking the right subjects. Not everyone needs to be a nuclear expert, but they do need to pick the right disciplines to feed into that pipeline that we're going to need for the nuclear workforce of the future. The other thing I just want to touch on also is it's not always necessarily the early careers program. It's also the mid careers where people have already got very rich experience and skills in disciplines that can be upskilled and cross-skilled for the nuclear workforce. So we shouldn't forget about that. There's things like people talk about micro-credentials, you know. We do need to be agile in the way we train people and cross-train people. The technologies that are happening so rapidly, there isn't time to go through those very structured programs where you have to spend years getting a degree. There are these micro-credentials that recognize certain qualifications and provide you with that short, sharp certification so that you can move around the industry a lot quicker and faster. And there's going to need to be a lot more these types of techniques that will need to be adopted for the future to support the workforce.
Yeah, thanks so much, Venessa, and a great reminder that it's not all about early career, mid-career as well. You might already have expertise you don't see as part of the nuclear workforce, but they are. Grant was asking about tracking SMR developments overseas, and Tony Irwin has shared a website there, smrnuclear.com.au, and says, Engineers Australia is establishing nuclear area of practice to support engineers moving into nuclear. So that's another example of someone with a certain career path moving into nuclear. Now I'll go to you next, Hugh. You know, how do we adapt to this potential future that we can't see when it comes to nuclear?
Well, you can't see me either because I'm not allowed to use my video. So Here we go. Maybe I can now.
Ta-da.
Okay, good. I'm not as positive as a lot of people. I mean, as I said at the beginning, I worked on small modular reactors 40 years ago, and we've yet to see an SMR. And I do think SMRs are the great hope of the nuclear industry. Let's be clear, you know, because we are still on type two kind of reactors in general. We're still building large PWRs with big cost overruns and huge development time frames, right? Even in areas that we really know well, like Hinkley Point in the UK, which is this, third generation reactor, exactly the same area, but it's still taking 20 years and 100% over budget to put one reactor into place. So SMRs are going to be important if we're going to change the game. The problem is no one has ever yet built an SMR and put it into production, all right? So we have not started the hard bit yet, which is every time you put a new reactor in, and there are lots of really clever designs for new reactors, pebble bed reactors, molten salt reactors, breeders and so on. Many of these designs of which have been around for, 60 years, truthfully. The challenge is getting it into production and then figuring out how to use it and making sure that you're using it properly and all the little bits that you never expected to go wrong that go wrong, if you see what I mean, which is why we end up using the same reactors today that we were using 50 years ago, because we know how they work. You know, it's the same argument about aircraft. We know, why does an A380 look like a Boeing 707? Because we know it works. And so I worried a little bit that people are getting a bit gung-ho too early. When someone actually puts an SMR into production and it's actually had a few years of operating experience and people start to buy it, at that point, we might just about consider using it in Australia. And that would not be an unreasonable thing to do. At this point, I think that's at least 15 years away. All right. Well,
that's great to know your prediction for the future. And I know there are some links
even,
there.
But even in the submarine nuclear reactors, right? At the current pace where that is advertised, we will not be building submarines here for another 20 years.
Yeah, right? So we need to think about the immediate future as well, right?
So I think there is more of a challenge as to what are we going to do in the near term versus what are we going to do in those longer terms. So people who take up a nuclear engineering degree today will not have a nuclear reactor to work on for most of their career at this point.
Yeah, that's really interesting to hear. Thank you so much for that perspective, Hugh. Jasmin, I want to throw to you to answer when it comes to what you think the future of nuclear is.
Yeah, so looking from a global perspective, the IAEA has actually, so International Atomic Energy Agency, has actually invested quite heavily as part of the United Nations Sustainability Goals and Nuclear for Climate in countries around Africa and Asia to help them develop nuclear power programs. So we will see across our region a heap of nuclear power plants being built to provide clean energy regionally. Africa has already started building some nuclear power plants and have started building their industry. So I think the future for nuclear globally is actually quite interesting. And I think there's a lot Australia can learn from that in how developing countries are introducing nuclear power as part of their sustainability and clean energy goals. So I'm actually a bit more optimistic as someone with a nuclear engineering background. I think it's sad if I never get to step into a reactor core, but I think there are big opportunities globally around nuclear and the future of nuclear careers through a lot of the Nuclear for Climate work that the International Atomic Energy Agency is doing.
Thanks so much, Jasmin. And yeah, we are part of a global workforce when it comes to these topics. Now, Tony, last but not least, as we come up to the end of the hour, what's your thoughts about where we're headed in terms of the future?
Oh, I'm really hoping we have a domestic nuclear energy industry, but I do think that is some way off, and certainly, looking at work that we do across a whole range of different industries, we're not maybe so concentrated on the nuclear aspects. We've got mining, mineral process. So here in South Australia, we've got uranium mining, we've got Maralinga, so there's radio ecology projects. Australian Radioactive Waste Agency, the BRAGS Proton Therapy Facility. AUKUS is going to be based out of Adelaide. So we have quite an extended use of radiation, not more so the nuclear engineering aspect. So that's that radiation safety and all those sorts of things. I will point out one thing, though, is that at some point the world is going to have to come to the conclusion. I've been to a couple of minerals conferences now. There's not enough minerals on the planet for us to go renewable. There's not enough copper. There's not enough cobalt and a whole heap of other rare earth minerals. So we're going to need to be able to make electricity somehow. So that's where I think nuclear may fit in.
Thanks so much, Tony. And thanks to all of our panelists and to everyone in the audience for joining us, for offering your own insights as well as your questions. That brings us to the end of this in our innovation series. There will be some links shared in the chat, though. I really want to encourage you to keep an eye out and consider joining newsletters when it comes to Science Meets Business. You can keep an eye out there for future series like this, as well as ANSTO. Please do stay invested, stay interested in the future of the workforce and the different skills and knowledge transfer that will require. Thanks so much, everyone. Enjoy the rest of your day. And Karis is just and Heather are just sharing a couple of links there for you to take a look at. Thanks again. Bye.